Hello students, hope you are all doing well. So today we will just see the need of object-oriented programming. So prior to this, we will just see that what is the evolution of language. So the language has evolved in such a way that the earlier machines or the earlier computers were completely dependent on the machine language. Okay, so basically in machine language, the main task is the program or the instructions are dependent on a particular machine. So when we write a particular statement, so this statement is in the form of an instruction that a machine can understand. Like it can be in the form of binaries. But if we say that the particular language or the particular statement is in the form of binary, then it is very difficult for a user to write a code in the form of binary or in the form of a machine language, because the bits or the bytes, the bits means the combination of 0 and 1. If we write the program or the blocks in the form of 0 and 1, then it becomes very vague. It becomes very vague for the programmer to understand when he is in a position to debug the code, because 1001 is nothing. It is you can say it is nothing for a programmer, because it is not accepted as a language for a programmer. It doesn't have any syntax. But for a machine, it is a set of rules that it can follow. So there was a requirement of a language so that it can be easily understandable by a programmer. So after the machine language, assembly language came into existence. So the assembly language is in the form of mnemonics. So in this assembly language, we have certain set of instructions. Likewise, you can say that in embedded system programmings or in hardware programming, it is completely based on assembly language. For example, we have a statement like MUL P, Q. It means we have to multiply Q with P. ACCA, it means we have to store this value in an accumulator or into an storage. Move M, N, it means we have to move the contents of N to M. Go to 4500, it means we have to jump into an instruction that is 4500th line. So assembly language is in the form of mnemonics. So after that, because there were some disadvantages of assembly languages also. The main disadvantage of assembly language is that it doesn't follow any programming construct. Programming construct means there were no loops, no if else, no decision making constructs were present in assembly language. So to overcome the assembly language, the programmers develop another type of language that is known as structured or functional language. So as the name suggests, structured or functional, it means that the main focus was on the functions. It means we can say that like there is a programming language C. So in C, we divide a big logic into small modules or small procedures or small subroutines, and these subroutines are basically known as the functions. So in functions, we can do the decision making task, we can create loops, we can provide the conditions like if else conditions, programming constructs can be made. But the main disadvantage of this structured or functional language is that the programmer has the capability to completely depend on the function rather than data. So if we are completely dependent on function, if we focus more on function or on functionality, then the data will be at stake. So the security of data is the main priority. So in a structured or in functional language, the main concern for the programmers is functions or the modules, and these functions or modules are being processed, okay, in isolation or in correlation with each other. But the data is being shared globally to each function that has been divided, that has been broken down from a bigger function or from a bigger logic. So you can say that the main focus is on functions and the data is being treated as global. So in functional or in structured programming like C, the data is a global entity, and if we keep the data as a global entity, then it can be shared by any outside function. And if it is shared by any outside function, then there is a high probability that any outside function can also change the content of this data, and simultaneously this data may be replicated to other functions that has been changed now. So data integrity is at stake. So a language was required that should be more focused on data, or you can say that should be more focused on the data safety, and such language that came up was the object-oriented programming language. So the concept of objects were being introduced. Okay, so the object is now correlated to data. So in the later subsequent lectures, we'll see that how this object is correlated to data. So now we can say in this modern era, or in this computing, or in this digitized era, that data is everything. So as you are seeing nowadays, that everything is data. Okay, software systems are nothing but software is a concept that manages the data. Okay, software is a system, or it is a logical entity that is managing the data, or that is managing the flow of information. So if we say that we want our data to be shared with each entity, and if we don't keep any security mechanism on the data, then there is a high chance that this data will be leaked out. Okay, so as we have seen that in Facebook also, the Facebook has leaked so many data of the users, and there are many companies that are leaking the data. Okay, the data breaching is highly in the market as in the present scenario. And in this present context, you have seen that our government has also taken certain steps, and it has banned that 52 apps that were responsible for leaking the data of the individual or for our. And it is not a very good thing, that if we are just, we are not concentrating on our data, and we are using such type of softwares, that are taking our information without our consent, then it is a threat. It is a threat to the nation as well as to the individual. So in present context, there are different categories where we study about data. So for example, you can say big data. So big data means it is a collection of data. There is a large amount of data that is to be processed, and we are just in a condition to just mine that particular data in order to extract the logical information out of the data, because not every data is important to us. There is some particular information that can be extracted from this particular data that we'll just discuss in the subsequent lecture. So here the main focus, or the main understanding, or the main concept is that the object-oriented programming concept, or the object-oriented programming language, is mainly focused on data rather than functions. Okay, so the functionality is not a main concern here. Rather data is of prime importance. So the data should be managed, and it should be properly arranged so that the particular functions that are in the vicinity of this particular data can access the data locally. So now we'll just see an example. This example is this is a scenario of an structured or a functional programming language, where we can say that there is a function f, okay, or you can say it is a logic, it is a bigger logic that has been broken down into smaller logics, that is f1, f2 and f3. So a bigger problem f has been broken down into smaller sub problems f1, f2 and f3. F1 has certain line of codes, f2 has certain line of codes and f3 has certain line of codes. And we are, okay, individually we are just compiling f1, okay, if there is any error in f1, then it can be individually held in this particular block. So there is no need to compile to check f2 and f3 simultaneously if there is any error in f1 block. So here we can say that our task of debugging is easy, but at the same time we can say if there are three variables a, b, c that are declared globally, so these global variables can be accessed, or you can say these global variables can be available to f1 and f2 and f3. They can be available because they are global variables. So we can just, okay, create a scenario. For example, f1 and f2, okay, f1 and f2 requires these variables, or they are in direct contact with these variables, that is a, b and c, but at certain point of time this f3 block, okay, it doesn't require, okay, these a, b, c variables. This f3 block is not in a position, or it doesn't have any requirement of these variables, you can say. So what happens, but these a, b, c variables are available to f3, okay, f3 doesn't require these variables, but these variables are, as we have declared them globally, but they are available to f3. So there can be, okay, accidentally you can say there can be a trigger can be there, okay, where this f3 can, okay, manipulate the data, or this f3 can change the contents of this variables a, b and c, and due to which these changed contents will be reflected in f1 and f2, and that will change, okay, the whole scenario. So what F3 is doing, F3 is changing the content of the variable, okay, so the data theft, you can say the data is now being changed, okay, there is a change in the data, and this changed data is now given to F1 and F2. That should not be the case. So F1 and F2 is now working on the changed value of the data, so the data is not safe, the outside function is manipulating the data. So here, this is the main disadvantage of structured or the functional programming language. So C is a structured functional programming language that incorporates this particular scenario. So object-oriented programming language, okay, should take the charge, okay, in order to make our data more safe. So in this particular scenario, what is happening, we are just creating objects, okay, rather than functions. So what is happening, there are three objects, okay, rather than three functions, object 1, object 2 and object 3. Each object contains, okay, a local variable a, b and c. So now the variables or the attributes are given, okay, as a local to these objects, okay, and at the same time the functions, okay, f1, f2 and f3, these functions are, okay, also a part of the objects, okay, in such a way such that function f1 is responsible of accessing its local variable only, okay, and this particular data has been encapsulated in an object object1, okay, so object 1 or o1, you can say o1 is encapsulating the local data or the attribute and its corresponding member function that is responsible to access it, okay. So now f1 has the rights to access A, okay, f1 cannot access B, f1 cannot access C, f1 cannot access f2, f1 cannot access f3. Now each of the function has given the priority to access its own variables in its own vicinity. Okay, so this is a very powerful concept of objects. So now the functionality is not of prime importance. Now there is a concept of objects. So what object has done? Object has encapsulated, okay, a capsule has been made in which the variables or the attributes, you can say, and the member functions that are responsible in accessing these attributes have been bind together into a single unit, and this single unit is known as object. Okay, so here ABC is the data, and what we are doing, we are hiding the data. Okay, so the data is being hidden. So this data A is being hidden from F2 as well as from F3. Now F2 and F3 cannot change the content of A. Similarly, F1 cannot change the content of B, F1 cannot change the content of C, and so on. So the data safety is preserved. Okay, the data security is high, data hiding concept is there, and only the variables can be accessed by the corresponding member functions in its vicinity. So object oriented programming language is very important. Okay, so you can say that all the transactions that we do in our in our bank, so the banking transaction management systems also work in this similar way. Okay, because it is also an application software, and you have seen in the last lecture that object oriented programming language can create application softwares. So it is a very powerful language in which we have to keep the data safe. Data safety is of prime importance. So in this way structured programming language lags, and we can say that object oriented programming language wins over the structured or the functional programming language.